Thank you very much. Well, it's a pleasure, in fact, to present the work or this presentation prepared by my colleague in the Libro. So it deals with the bonds. So, well, in fact, as you see in this image, we have several applications where, for instance, you see for the flexural strengthening, also for benching, even for shear. So in this case, in fact, the bond is a fundamental issue. So we need to avoid premature debonding between the FRP systems and the concrete substrate. Well, in fact, when we are bonding an FRP system, we see in this image that we have the concrete substrate, we have the adhesive, and yes, it's a lot of noise, it's okay. And the adhesive, and then we have the FRP. So our noise is better. We can have a bond, what is indicated by cohesive failure multiplied concrete substrate in the top. We can have a bond between the adhesive and the concrete. We can have also cohesive failure through the adhesive and between the adhesive and the FRP. All of these types of failure modes anticipate the tensile capacity that is capable to mobilize when we are using FRP. So we see in the bottom image, so in fact in this part, the bonding of the FRP from the concrete, and in this case in the beam, we have the propagation of the failure in between the FRP and the concrete, and also is some part of the concrete that is attached. So this is a hip-off, type of hip-off failure mode. And as I indicated, this anticipates the tensile capacity of the FRP. So in this slide, we see that we have, or we are concerned mainly to two types of possible failure modes, or primitive failure modes. From the anchorage, is and the bonding, number one, where we have a concentration or a coupling between normal stress and shear, in plane shear. And in the middle of the beam, when we have a flexural crack, and this flexural crack, in fact, can introduce a bonding between the FRP and the concrete substrate. In the case of a shear failure crack, or in the case of a shear crack that is formed, so we can anticipate even the failure of the FRP, because we have shear sliding and opening. This is a mixed mode, and this mixed mode introduce, in fact, high stress concentrations in the interface between the FRP and the concrete substrate. So this is what we see here. So in our left part, so we have a primitive debonding at the extreme part of the FRP. In the bottom, we see an incline, a shear crack, and the shear crack, as you see, so mobilized debonding, and also that is provoked by in the intersection between shear crack and the FRP, is introducing, in fact, an in-plane shear and also a normal stress components, as we see later. So you can also see in your right part that, in fact, the flexural crack, as we see, flexural crack can introduce this stress concentration in the intersection of the flexural crack in the FRP and consequently the lamination. In the bottom part, we have issue as well. So, how we are addressing this problem? We introduce a local positive law, that is the relation between the in-plane shear and sliding between the FRP and the concrete substrate. This obviously is a simple diagram. So it's an elastic, so that is defined by elastic stiffness and with a sliding corresponding peak value and the ball strength. And then we have a soft stage up to maximum value that in this diagram is S. So from the cost from the carbon equation, so that simulates the interface, we see that we have S is sliding, TF is the perimeter of the FRP in contact bonded to the concrete substrate, and in the bottom we have the axial stiffness of the FRP that is dependent on the characteristic of or on the material of the FRP, that is EF, and the AF is the cross-section area of the FRP. And then we have LBS, LBS is precisely the bonds in cross-section. So we can simplify this linear bond-slip relationship in order to become only one softening, so only one diagram, only one branch in order to simplify the equation. So this is the equation. The first one is to simulate the linear part, the intermediate one is the softening, and after the last one is the one that simulates totally the bonding of the concrete. So if we use a more complex bond-slip relationship, that is the one that we have in the left part in the top, this is more realistic in fact. So we have a linear branch, then we have a hardening stage following by a softening. And when we use this type of relationship, that in fact is more realistic, and from the load versus displacement in the FRP system, we see that the linear branch is controlling the linear force displacement, the hardening stage is controlling the intermediate stage, and finally the softening is the one that governs the last stage of the force displacement. So in the bottom part we see that when we are pulling the FRP, so we have, as we see, an increment, or we have an evolution of the bond stress along the bond transfer length. So, as when the sliding is increasing between the FRP and the concrete substrate, we realize that the peak bond stress is moving inside the bond transfer length. So this is so I will not explain the equations, but what happens? So we see is the bond slip, bond stress coming, going inside of the bond length, and so it's like a wave, it's a wave propagation. And what is important is that in fact the bonds, the strains in the FRP are increasing when the load is increasing or is applied to the FRP. So, a very important aspect is this situation. So, imagine that in this case, in the right finger, in the top, imagine that the FRP is totally under. So, if it is under, when the beam is being loaded, what happens? At a certain distance from the point, from the support, it is formed some cracks in concrete. And when this crack is formed, we have an increment on the displacement. We see these peaks run by the circle in blue line. So, and when the main crack is formed, and this main crack obviously is where in the section where we have the maximum moment, we see a very interesting aspect is that look for now the graph in the bottom. So we, in the bottom, we have the stress installed in the existing steel bars, in the flexural reinforcement, and in the FRP. When the existing steel reinforcement yields, what happens? So the FRP takes the total almost or the remaining increase of load, and we have an increase of the strain in the end stress possibility in the FRP. So, however, when the FRP is not anchored, this is now the situation of the FRP, is the lower headline, so in the bottom of the beam, so it's not anchored. In this case, what happens? When the beam is loaded, we start having an increase of the sliding in the extremity of the FRP, the bond anchorage. So, and consequently, what happens is that we have a much higher probability to have a debonding from the extremity. So that if we avoid this premature failure mode, so in fact, when the flexural cracks, when if it is possible to mobilize the flexural capacity, the early initiation of the existing steel reinforcement, in fact, again, we see that we have an abundant increase in the strain in the FRP. So this is a typical test that we evaluate to obtain or to derive information to establish an equation for effective bond length. Effective is LE. So, and this is an important parameter that we, as engineers for design this type of straining system, we need to know, we need to evaluate. So this parameter is being obtained by performing pull-out tests of this type. So this, we have two types of tests in this figure. In the bottom part is a pull-out bending test, where it is being installed some strain gauge to measure the strain and possibly to derive the sliding between the FRP and the components. But we can also introduce some apparatus to measure directly the loading density and frequency. So the photo is a type of test. And from this test, and from this data, it was obtained by simplification of this data, this equation that will define the effective bond length. What is important to verify is that it depends on the stiffness, is directly dependent on the stiffness of FRP, Young's model, and the thickness of FRP. This means that as larger is the stiffness of FRP, we need longer bond length. So, in the opposite, when we have a higher bond strength, this is the denominator, we need a smaller bond length. So this is the important aspect. So, and if we assume this first equation is obtained when we assume a rigid soft load, like the one that is in red. If we assume a bilinear that in fact is more rigorous, we have a little bit more complicated equation, but it's not so much because it's the one that we have in the bottom. And we introduce now a concept of fracture energy. This fracture energy is the area behind the bond slip relationship. But in fact, the fracture energy can be established, can be service dependent on the compressive strength. And consequently, we can again simplify the equation. And look again, we have the bond. The effective bond length dependent at the end on the two main aspects, the stiffness of the FRP and the concrete compressive strength. So, in bottom, we have two equations, one that is based on average values, and the bottom one is based on 5% characteristic value. So, in these two graphs, we see clearly that we have two FRP systems. The one that is in the left corresponds to the sheets that we are using normally for flexural and also for shear. So Georg's model is almost close to the steel, and the thickness is very, very small, 0.165 millimeter. The other one, at the right, you have another FRP system that is much more stiff. So the thickness is 1.4. It's about 10 times higher thickness than the one in the left. And you can see that in fact from the graphs, that when the concrete, the quality of the substrate is increasing, we need a smaller bond transfer length, because the effective length is smaller. But we can also see that when we have a stiffer FRP system, that is the one that is in the right, so we need a higher effective bond length. Okay? So this is an important aspect. So now another important aspect is to evaluate the tensile strength in the FRP to avoid these two types of failure modes. So the one that I am now introducing is to avoid the end crash. So we need to evaluate what is the tensile strength is tau in the FRP to avoid the premature failure mode by end crash. And these equations are those that are in the FIM model. And so that depends again on the characteristics of the FRP, Young's model, and the thickness, DF, depends on the fracture energy, GF, and also a parameter that governs the length of the bond transfer. If EL is equal to 1, when the bond transfer length is higher than the effective, this means that we are able to mobilize the total capacity of the FRP. So when the bond length LB is smaller than the effective, we make like an interpolation. So this is the equation now to evaluate the average value of the tensile strength in the FRP to avoid the premature failure mode by the bond. The characteristic and the design. So the design is the same like the characteristic, but is divided by the safety factor. And the safety factor that is being proposed is 1.5. So the KM and KB was calibrated, the KM was calibrated from the data, experimental data, and the values that is being proposed is the KM is 0.25 and KK is equal for the 5% characteristic value is 0.17. So you can see in this slide that in fact, so we see experimental data, the circles are experimental data. And clearly we verify that the when we increase the stiffness of the FRP, remember stiffness is a product in this case of the Young's model, and is a characteristic of the material, and DF is the thickness, when this increases, in fact, the maximum tensile load that can be applied to avoid this type of failure mode increases. So, for the intermediate crack, if you remember, when we have a flexural crack, or even a shear crack, so, and when these cracks cross the FRP, as we see here in this small figure, at yellow color, so we have a propagation from the crack to the sides, and we have, why? Because we have in-plane shear as well as normal stress component, we see this. And then we obtain this type of error modes at least in this model. So how to avoids this type of failure mode, or how we can estimate the tensile load, tensile stress installing FRP when this type of failure mode is occurring. So we need only to take the value, the equation that we estimate for the end equation, that is FFPM, and multiply prime factor KCRM. KCRM, that is the average value, or a characteristic KCRK. And finally, to obtain the design value, is to divide by safety factor, that is also 1.5. So, after we have evaluated the tensile stress corresponding to this intermediate crack, so we obtain the strain, the maximum strain that can be installed, divided by this stress that is in question 517, divided by this stress by the Young's model of the material of the FRP. And again, from this experimental data, we see that in fact, when the stiffness of the FRP increases, so the maximal tensile load that can tensile stress applied in the FRP is increasing, and the opposite, because if CL is the quality, represents the quality of the boundary of substrate, when we have better substrate, in fact, we can have a higher load stress applied. Finally, for the NSM, so we did a lot of tests with the group, so almost all institutions involved in this group has carried out this pull-up test. And the most important aspect so is that we realized that when the stiffness of the NSM system is increasing, the maximum bone stress is decreasing. This is an important aspect. Another aspect again is that the quality of the concrete, surrounding concrete, when it is better, we can apply a higher bone stress. So we see here, so look, this is an important result. So the circles are experimental data, and clearly we see that the maximum strain that we can apply is increasing when PF is the perimeter. This means that when we use an NSM system with a larger ratio between the perimeter that is in contact with the substrate and the cross section, we are having in fact a more efficient NSM system. And but when the axial stiffness is increasing, this is in the denominator. So when the axial stiffness of the NSM increases, in fact, the maximum possible strain to be applied is increasing. So, and I think this is for average, for characteristics, that's the same tendency, and we have equations for, and I suppose is essential of this presentation. Thank you very much.